Chapter 9. Consequentialism, Its Nature and Attractions. Do all the good you can, by all the means you can, in all the ways you can, in all the places you can, at all the times you can, to all the people you can, as long as ever you can. Thus did John Wesley, English religious thinker and founder of the Methodist Church, sum up his philosophy of life. Our business here on earth is to do good, as much and as often as we can. Our efforts must extend beyond ourselves to all whom we might help. Benevolence should be our guiding aim, and a life of altruism and good works should be the record we leave behind. Wesley's advice can be summarized quite simply in the motto that defines the consequentialist outlook: do as much good as you can. It is a very attractive picture of the moral life. It requires us to move beyond egoistic concerns and to focus on improving the lives of others as well as our own. We must make the world the best place it can be. Can anyone seriously argue with such a claim? Some very fine philosophers have thought it impossible to reject this view. G.E. Moore, an English thinker famous in his day for his rigorous thought, declared it plain that what is right is whatever produces the most good. If you have a choice between two options, and the first is less good than the second, choosing the first can't possibly be right. Acts are morally right just because they maximize the amount of goodness in the world. Moore thought that those who failed to accept this simply didn't know what they were talking about. Certainly, any plausible moral theory will insist on the central importance of doing good. We commonly justify our actions by pointing to the good they did, and criticize actions by showing that they caused unnecessary harm. That makes perfect sense if consequentialism is correct. Before we get to the details of the consequentialist picture, let's briefly consider a contemporary puzzle, the morality of capital punishment, that can illuminate the basic nature of this ethical outlook. There are many views about the morality of the death penalty, but most of them can be sorted into two large groups. In the first, consequentialist camp, people insist that such punishment is justified only if it improves our lives. It will have to decrease crime, increase security, and expand respect for human life. If capital punishment is to be justified, we must show that we will be better off with it than without it. We must look to the future and ask three things. What are the benefits of executing criminals? What are the drawbacks? Which policy would yield the greatest cost-benefit ratio? Survey all of the available options. Whichever policy is optimific, i.e., such as to yield the greatest balance of benefits over drawbacks, is the one that morality requires. A second group asks not about what the future will hold, but rather about what the past requires of us. Specifically, the focus is on whether certain people deserve to be killed for the crimes they have committed. On this line of thinking, even if the death penalty is extremely costly, fails to prevent crime, and perhaps even increases the crime rate by making the population more hard-hearted, we should still impose it if we can show that criminals deserve to be executed. Before we consider making people happy or reducing their misery, we must first do justice. If giving out just desserts happens to reduce crime, so much the better. But if it doesn't, we should still execute the murderers among us if they deserve it. My aim here isn't to try to resolve this thorny issue, but rather to reveal what is distinctive about the consequentialist approach to ethics. Consequentialists are those who encourage us not to cry over spilled milk. They direct our attention in the future, not the past. They ask us to look at the consequences of our actions or policies, hence the name of their theory. For them, the ends justify the means, so long as the ends are good enough. When we want to know whether our plans are in line with morality, we will ask about results. Did my action achieve better results than any other I could have done? If so, then my action was morally required. If not, then it wasn't. The nature of consequentialism, its structure. Consequentialism says that an action is morally required just because it produces the best overall results, i.e., is optimific. But how can we determine whether an act is optimific? It won't always be an easy thing to do in practice, but in theory, it's pretty straightforward. There are five steps to this process. 1. First, identify what is intrinsically good, valuable in and of itself, and worth having for its own sake. Familiar candidates include happiness, autonomy, knowledge, and virtue. 2. Next, identify what is intrinsically bad, i.e., bad all by itself. Examples might include physical pain, mental anguish, sadistic impulses, and the betrayal of innocence. 3. Then determine all of your options. Which actions are open to you at the moment? 4. For each option, determine the value of its results. How much of what is intrinsically good will each action bring about? How much of what is intrinsically bad? 5. Finally, pick the action that yields the best balance, the highest ratio of good to bad results. That is the optimific choice. That is your moral duty. Doing anything else, failing to strike the greatest balance of good over bad, is immoral. We can develop dozens of different versions of consequentialism depending on which things we regard as intrinsically valuable. We could say, for instance, that acts are right just in case they yield the greatest improvement in environmental health, or best advance the cause of world peace, or do more than any other action to increase the amount of knowledge in the world. Each of these is a version of consequentialism. Thus, consequentialism isn't just a single theory, but is rather a family of theories, united by their agreement that results are what matter in ethics. We can't discuss every member of the family here, so I will restrict my attention, for the most part, to its most prominent version, ACT Utilitarianism. According to ACT Utilitarianism, well-being is the only thing that is intrinsically valuable, and faring poorly is the only thing that is intrinsically bad. Thus, this view states that an action is morally required just because it does more to improve overall well-being than any other action you could have done in the circumstances. Philosophers call this ultimate moral standard the principle of utility. Some utilitarians have been hedonists, others desire satisfaction theorists. Still others have defended the idea that there are a variety of things that directly contribute to our welfare. At present, we don't need to take a stand on this matter. The important point is that, according to ACT Utilitarianism, acts are right just because they maximize the overall amount of well-being in the world. When there are attractions and difficulties that are specific to ACT Utilitarianism as opposed to other versions of consequentialism, I note them. But for the most part, we can get a good sense of the consequentialist ethic just by focusing on ACT Utilitarianism. Maximizing goodness. If ACT Utilitarianism, henceforth just utilitarianism, is correct, then we are duty-bound to maximize well-being. But what exactly does this mean? John Stuart Mill, one of the greatest utilitarians, famously summarized the utilitarian outlook by saying that it required us to create the greatest good for the greatest number. But this popular slogan overlooks an important nuance, one that Mill was well aware of. Mill was a hedonist who believed that only happiness was intrinsically valuable and only misery was intrinsically bad. Let's just assume the truth of hedonism for the moment to better appreciate what maximizing goodness requires. If we combine utilitarianism and hedonism, we get this ultimate moral principle: produce the greatest overall balance of happiness over misery. There are two common misunderstandings of this principle. Let's clear them out of the way first so that we can see what Mill really had in mind. First misunderstanding. In choosing among acts that benefit people, we must benefit the greatest number of people. Mill rejects this. Suppose we have to choose between an act that benefits more people and one that benefits fewer. Mill's principle does not say that we automatically have to pick the first option. That's because the benefit to the majority may be very small, whereas the benefit to the minority may be very large. Imagine that the legislature has a surplus this year. They could spend that money giving 90% of the citizens a $50 gas coupon. Or they could spend that money trying to prevent homelessness and starvation among the poorest 10%. In a variety of plausible scenarios, giving the money to the poor will yield more good, even though that benefits fewer people. If that is so, then the money must be directed to combat poverty. Second misunderstanding. We must always choose that action that creates the greatest amount of happiness. Mill also rejects this. Suppose we have to choose between two plans. The first creates more happiness than the second. Mill's principle does not say that we automatically have to favor the first plan. That's because the first plan may also create a huge amount of misery, while the second plan creates very little. Imagine a Roman emperor who wanted to please his public. His choice? Offer gladiator contests or a series of grand athletic competitions. Suppose that watching the gladiators would create more happiness. But imagine, reasonably, that this would also create much more misery than the athletic games would do. It might be that the games would produce the greatest net balance of happiness over misery, even though more total happiness would have been created by offering a chance to see men killing one another. The correct interpretation. Utilitarians tell us to do what brings about the best overall situation by choosing the act that creates the greatest net balance of happiness over unhappiness. So out with the gladiators and in with the athletes. Moral knowledge. Utilitarians make the rightness of an action depend on all of its results, no matter how long after the action they occur. There is no statute of limitations on counting consequences. Sometimes the results of one's actions do not last more than a moment. In other cases, they may continue for decades or centuries. Just think of Lincoln's assassination or Jesus' crucifixion. This raises an immediate worry. If the rightness of an action depends on all of its results, and these haven't yet occurred, then how can we know whether an action is the right one to do? Utilitarians are split on how best to answer this question. The first group thinks that the morality of actions depends on their actual results. The second group thinks that it depends instead on their expected results. This makes a big difference in the utilitarian account of how we gain moral knowledge. The standard view is the first one. Right actions are those that actually bring about the best possible results. But since these are still in the future when the action is performed, we can never be completely sure that what we are about to do is the right thing. Yet, every moral theory has to allow for some degree of moral ignorance, cases where we don't know what is right or wrong. We are not morally infallible. Many utilitarians expect this by saying that since we don't have a crystal ball and can't perfectly predict the future, we can never be certain in advance that our actions are morally right. Still, there is a huge amount of past experience that we can call upon. For instance, we can be reasonably sure that if we were to pick up a gun and shoot a perfect stranger at point-blank range, then the results would not be optimistic. True, we can't be absolutely certain of this. That stranger could be the next Stalin or Bin Laden, for instance. But we should not expect certainty when it comes to moral questions. Other utilitarians are uncomfortable with this. They want to make moral knowledge easier to get. As they see it, we should be able to know the morality of our acts when we perform them, rather than having to wait until all of the results are in. After all, if we had to wait for those results, we might never know the morality of some of our actions, since they could have unexpected results that occur even after our deaths. For utilitarians in this second camp, the solution to this worry is to make the rightness of actions depend not on their actual results, but on their expected results. On this view, acts are morally required just because they are reasonably expected to be optimistic. Since we are often in a position to make reasonable predictions about the results of our actions, we can often know, prior to performing them, whether they are morally right or wrong. Actual versus expected results. Suppose that, with the best possible motives, I take an aged stranger's arm and help him across the street. As we cross, a reckless driver crashes into my companion, killing him. Had I not tried to be kind, he would still be at the curb, a bit delayed but unharmed. If the morality of an act depends on its actual results, then, from a utilitarian perspective, I did something immoral. A different option, refusing to help the man across the street, would have had better results. If that sounds harsh, there is an easy remedy. If we evaluate actions based on their expected results, then, morally speaking, I am in the clear. That's because anyone in my shoes could reasonably expect that helping the man across the street would have had excellent results. Interestingly, most utilitarians reject the view that makes rightness a matter of expected rather than actual results. The expected results version makes it easier to get moral knowledge and does not condemn actions that are reasonably expected to be optimific. But it has two problems that have lost it most of its supporters. First, it will sometimes require actions that turn out to have disastrous results when other options would have produced much better outcomes. Such acts that we expect to turn out well end up doing great harm, and when that is so, this proposal would still regard the disastrous actions as morally right. Suppose, for instance, that I'm a member of a parole board and have excellent evidence that a criminal has had a change of heart. I authorize his release and later read that he went on a killing spree just days afterward. Most utilitarians find it extremely difficult to morally prefer an act that resulted in many innocent deaths over one that would have resulted in none. They would say that my action was the wrong one, though, as we'll shortly see, I am not to be blamed for it, since I had intended to bring about good results. Second, some actions are expected to turn out badly, but end up with surprisingly good results. I remember a time as a kid when I got up my courage and confronted a bully, even though I thought that this would only make him nastier to me and his other victims. Instead, he unexpectedly backed down and stopped his harassment. If utilitarians make rightness a matter of expected results, then they must judge my action to be immoral, but condemning an act with excellent results is too much for most utilitarians to stomach. Assessing actions and intentions. If we stick to the classic version of utilitarianism, one that judges actions on the basis of their actual results, what should we say about cases where good intentions yield awful results, or bad intentions yield pleasant surprises? Here, utilitarians will insist on separating the issues. They will have one standard for evaluating actions and another for judging intentions. Actions are right provided they are optimific, but intentions are morally good provided that they are reasonably expected to yield good results. So, in the case of my helping the pedestrian, these utilitarians would judge my action wrong while praising my intentions. On this view, we cannot immediately say that I am to blame just because I did something immoral, nor can we say that I am to be praised just because I did something right. Imagine an assassin whose bullet misses its target, ricochets, and miraculously hits both the assassin and his accomplice, disabling them, revealing their location, and leading to their quick capture. In that case, we condemn the assassins, but judge their action to be right, since it had the best possible results. On this view, there is no essential connection between the morality of an action and the morality of the intentions behind it. If you are trying to do harm when you had the chance to do good, then you are to blame, even if your action manages to maximize well-being. If you intend a kindness, then you are to be praised, even if, through no fault of your own, your action backfires and only misery results. Here is the picture thus far. Consequentialists say that our fundamental moral duty is to make the world the best place it can be. Utilitarians, in particular, understand this to mean that we must contribute as much to the improvement of well-being as we can. Though theorists differ, most claim that whether an action is optimific depends only on its actual and not expected results. All results count, not just those that occur in the short term. When we fail to maximize good results, we act wrongly, even if we had the best intentions. Though good intentions may earn us praise, they are irrelevant to an action's morality. When we pass up a chance to do an action that would have had better results, we are doing something wrong. Always. The attractions of utilitarianism. Impartiality. Utilitarianism is a doctrine of impartiality, and this is one of its great strengths. It tells us that the welfare of each person is equally morally valuable, whether rich or poor, white or black, male or female, religious or not, your well-being is just as important as anyone else's. In the gladiator example, for instance, we didn't have to ask whether the happiness went to wealthy nobles or impoverished slaves. It didn't matter. Everyone's well-being counts, and everyone's well-being counts equally. We nowadays take such equality for granted, but the idea, when advanced by the earliest utilitarians, was quite a radical one. Indeed, utilitarians have a long history of challenging conventional moral wisdom. Jeremy Bentham, whose Principles of Morals and Legislation gave the first really sophisticated defense of utilitarianism, was a dedicated abolitionist. Bentham's godson, John Stuart Mill, wrote one of the earliest and greatest works on behalf of female equality, On the Subjection of Women. Peter Singer, perhaps the most famous living philosopher, continues the utilitarian tradition of seeking to expand our moral concerns with his influential work on behalf of ethical vegetarianism and against animal experimentation. According to utilitarians, we develop a truly moral outlook only when we broaden our horizons so that we are not focused just on ourselves or on our friends, family, or fellow citizens. The moral point of view is nothing less than an impartial concern for everyone whose well-being may be affected by our actions. The ability to justify conventional moral wisdom. As the examples of abolitionism, sexual equality, and animal welfare show, utilitarians are not afraid of controversy. They know that their recommendations will sometimes conflict with popular opinion, but they don't regard that as a strike against their theory. Rather, they see it as a strike against popular opinion. That said, utilitarians think that most of our deeply held moral beliefs are correct. There is a special reason for this, one that utilitarians regard as a great advantage of their view. As they see it, utilitarianism does a better job than any competing moral theory in justifying our basic moral beliefs. Consider the things we regard, deep down, as seriously immoral. Slavery, rape, humiliating defenseless people, killing innocent victims. Each of these clearly tends to do more harm than good. Utilitarianism condemns such acts. So do we. Now consider the things we strongly believe to be morally right. Helping the poor, keeping promises, telling the truth, bravely facing danger. Such actions are highly beneficial. Utilitarianism commends them. So do we. Utilitarianism can also explain our shared views about virtues and vices. According to utilitarianism, a character trait is a virtue just because it tends to cause us to act in highly beneficial ways. Compassion, kindness, and benevolence appear on almost anyone's list of central moral virtues. Utilitarianism has a natural account of this. Such character traits tend to promote our flourishing and to reduce misery. Greed, malice, ingratitude, these are bound to make most people's top 10 list of moral vices. Utilitarianism easily explains this. When people are motivated by such things, they tend to harm others. Utilitarians thus condemn such traits as vices. So do we. Our core moral beliefs could be mistaken, but until we see an excellent argument for such skepticism, we are right to decide among competing moral theories by selecting one that justifies our deepest beliefs and clashes with only a few of them. No moral theory manages to do this perfectly. As we'll see, each of the major views captures some fundamental moral beliefs at the expense of some others. Still, utilitarianism earns pretty high marks in this department. Conflict resolution. One of the most important things that an ethical theory can do is to provide advice about how to resolve moral conflicts. Utilitarianism delivers. Because it has just a single ultimate rule, maximize well-being, it can offer concrete guidance where it is most needed. Consider this familiar moral puzzle. I overhear some nasty gossip about my friend. She later asks me whether people have been spreading rumors about her. I know that she is extremely sensitive, and that if I answer honestly, it will send her into a downward spiral for several days. I also know that the source of this gossip is someone who actually likes my friend and was acting impulsively and out of character. She's probably feeling bad about it already, and probably won't repeat this unkindness. Of course, we need to know a lot more about the situation before we can be confident about a recommendation, but if we just stick to the details given here, the utilitarian will advise me not to reveal what I have heard. Honesty may be the best policy, but that doesn't mean that full disclosure is always called for. When we consider our options, utilitarians tell us to pick the one that increases overall well-being. Telling the truth won't always do that. Utilitarianism thus gives us a clear method for resolving moral conflict. We can apply the principle of utility to determine which choice to make in difficult cases. John Stuart Mill saw this clearly. In a fascinating discussion at the end of his Utilitarianism, Mill touts the superiority of the utilitarian view of justice over its competitors. He does this, in part, through a discussion of taxation. We can all agree that our system of taxation must be just, but that doesn't get us very far. We can make a case that charging everyone an identical amount of money is just, since we are thereby treating everyone alike. Or we can insist that everyone pay the same percentage of his income, again, a form of treating everyone alike. Or we can require a graduated tax, taking a higher percentage from those who can most easily afford it. Which should we do? Fans of each of these ideas, and others, will offer many arguments on behalf of their position. Sorting it all out could be excruciating, and that is because we have no clear way of applying the test that tells us to adopt just policies. Utilitarianism cuts through the conflicting claims and offers direct advice. Maximize well-being. Of course, it's not always easy to know which tax policy will do this, but at least we have a clear direction for pursuing our question. Whenever we are faced with conflicting moral advice, utilitarianism can greatly simplify matters. It tells us to focus on just one question: which option will maximize well-being? Coming up with an answer will sometimes be hard, but at least we know where to look. That is, at least half the battle won. Moral flexibility. During the winter of 1846-47, members of the Donner Party, traveling by horse and coach in search of a pass through California's Sierra Nevada range, found themselves buried in heavy mountain snows. It wasn't long before their supplies of food and fuel ran out. Almost half of the 87 members of their party died that winter. Some of those who survived faced a terrible choice. They could starve to death or remain alive by eating the remains of their fellow travelers. In the choice faced by members of the Donner Party, one might regard the prohibition on eating human flesh as absolute, not to be violated under any conditions. Even though honoring the rule means losing one's life, some rules are never to be broken. Utilitarians would disagree. And their disagreement is based not on specific views about cannibalism, but on very general grounds. For utilitarians, no moral rule other than the principle of utility is absolute. It is morally okay to violate any rule, even one that prohibits cannibalism or torture or the killing of innocents, if doing so will raise overall well-being. Utilitarians think that this is an excellent thing that so many of us are unwilling even to contemplate such actions. Our reluctance is almost always beneficial, but in unusual situations, we are right to violate taboos or break familiar, deeply held moral rules if we maximize well-being in doing so. Utilitarianism is thus a doctrine of moral flexibility. Most of us think that moral rules must allow some exceptions. But where to draw the line? How do we know whether to follow a moral rule or to break it? Utilitarianism gives us an answer. Morality is not a free-for-all. It is not a case of anything goes. We ordinarily do best when we obey the familiar moral rules. Don't steal, lie, kill, etc. But there are times when we must stray from the conventional path in order to improve overall welfare. When we do this, we do right, even if it means breaking the traditional moral rules. The scope of the moral community. In the winter of 2007, two high school boys from Reading, Ohio, decided to have some fun. They sprayed Lysol into a cat's face, crushed its spine, popped its eyes out, impaled it with a stake, and dismembered it. Then they bragged to their classmates about what they had done. What these boys did was very wrong, and utilitarians have a ready explanation of this. Most competing moral theories do not. Utilitarians argue that animals are members of the moral community. To be a member of the moral community is to be important in your own right. It is to be owed a certain amount of respect. Membership in the moral community imposes a duty on everyone else to take one's needs seriously for one's own sake. Every moral theory needs to have a way to determine who gains entry to the moral community. The utilitarian test is recorded in a famous slogan by Jeremy Bentham. The question is not, can they reason, nor can they talk, but can they suffer? Tables and chairs are not members of the moral community. Neither are cars. We owe them nothing. They are important when they are, only because we care about them. If we had no interest in them at all, then there would be nothing wrong with having them destroyed. Utilitarianism easily explains their second-class status. Such things can't suffer, and so they have no independent moral importance. But animals are a different matter. They are members of the moral community. They are important in their own right. Their importance does not depend on whether we happen to care about them, and the utilitarian explanation of this is very plausible. Animals count because they can suffer. Those teenagers from Ohio caused excruciating, pointless suffering. That's why their actions were so terrible. Just to be clear, utilitarians allow that it is sometimes okay to harm members of the moral community. There are many cases in which maximizing overall well-being comes at a price. For instance, it may be acceptable to conduct certain intensely painful animal experiments, provided that they bring about very beneficial results. The point here is that, from the utilitarian perspective, we are not allowed to ignore the suffering of others. It doesn't matter whether the victims are human beings or not. Indeed, utilitarians have argued that species membership is, in itself, completely morally irrelevant. What counts is whether you can suffer, and non-humans can certainly do that. If an animal suffers to the same extent as a human, that is an equal misfortune. Harming a human is not, in and of itself, any worse than causing the same harm to a non-human animal. A number of utilitarians have advanced a powerful argument that relies on this controversial position. It is called the argument from marginal cases. 1. If it is immoral to kill and eat marginal human beings, and to painfully experiment on them, then it is immoral to treat non-human animals this way. 2. It is almost always immoral to kill and eat marginal human beings, and to painfully experiment on them. 3. Therefore, it is almost always immoral to kill and eat animals, and to painfully experiment on them. I dislike the name of this argument because I think it distasteful to refer to any human beings as marginal, but its name is so familiar in philosophical circles that we will stick with it here. Marginal human beings are those whose mental lives are no more developed than those of the non-human animals we routinely eat and experiment on. There are many cases of such developmental limitations, severe brain trauma, extreme mental retardation, and so on. The basic idea behind the argument for marginal cases is that such human beings are no more morally important than the animals we harm in our labs or factory farms. Since they are of equal importance, we must treat them equally. If we are not prepared to eat or experiment upon such human beings, then we shouldn't be willing to treat animals that way either. Many people find the argument from marginal cases repugnant. They recoil at giving animal interests the same weight as those of human beings. Utilitarians push back. Everyone counts, and everyone counts equally. Everyone means every member of the moral community. Animals are members, so their interests count for just as much as those of human beings. Almost no one rejects premise 2 of the argument from marginal cases. You've got to be awfully hard-hearted to be willing to subject marginal human beings to the sort of treatment we apply to animals in our labs and farms. True, there might be rare exceptions where such treatment is acceptable. That's the point of saying that it is almost always wrong to do such things to human beings. But these would have to be extremely unusual cases. So the real action occurs in premise 1. Its defenders support it in this way. They say that marginal human beings and farm and lab animals are moral equals. They are moral equals because, as utilitarians see it, they can equally suffer. And, as moral equals, anything that is wrong to do to one of them should be wrong to do to the others. The obvious place to attack this reasoning is with the claim that animals and marginal humans are moral equals. If you don't like that claim, then it is up to you to find a better test for inclusion in the moral community. Familiar examples are problematic. Perhaps the ability to reason is the relevant test. As we know, Bentham rejected this test, but even if he was wrong to do so, this isn't going to help. That's because the reasoning powers of marginal humans are no better than those of animals. In fact, some animals, such as pigs and primates, are very smart, and no doubt smarter than some human beings. There are many other tests of independent moral importance that philosophers have advanced. Here are some of the most popular ones. The ability, 1, to communicate, 2, to have emotions, 3, to elicit sympathy from others, 4, to be self-aware, 5, to be self-governing, 6. To assert claims on one's behalf. Or 7. To think about and plan for one's future. Utilitarians insist that the capacity to suffer is a better test of membership in the moral community than any of these 7 alternatives. But even if you have doubts about that, and many do, utilitarians will argue that animals and marginal humans fare equally well on each of these tests. Many animals possess these traits or abilities to the same degree as marginal human beings. In my experience, most people at this point try to argue in one of 2 ways. Some say that every human is more important than any animal, because God created each of us as an exalted being whose life has more value than that of any animal. Well, that's a possibility, but defending it is a task for theologians, as the defense will ultimately rest on claims about God's existence and his purposes and intentions. So we are going to leave this aside. Another thing that people often say in this context is that marginal human beings, just because they are human, are more important than animals. On this view, the test of whether you are a member of the moral community is whether you are a human. No matter how marginal a person is, he or she is still a human being, and so more important than any animal. But this is a bad argument. It clearly begs the question against the utilitarian. You are not going to accept this line of reasoning unless you already accept the view that all marginal humans are more important than all non-human animals. Further, we should ask why species membership is the all-important test of moral status. Your genetic code, or the species of your parents, doesn't seem to be what establishes your moral importance. To see this, imagine a time, perhaps not so far in the future, in which we encounter, or create, beings who are like us in every way, except that they are made of silicon. They think like us. They feel emotions as we do. They are self-aware. They feel pain. They look exactly like us. The only difference between them and us is which species we belong to. I don't know how to argue for this, and perhaps you disagree, but it seems to me that this difference doesn't justify treating these beings as second-class citizens. In fact, it seems that they are just as morally important as we are. After all, without cutting them open, we couldn't tell them apart from a human being, because they're identical to us in every way except the internal circuitry. If you share my view about this case, then you should reject the idea that species membership is, in itself, a morally important trait. And if that is so, then we can't resist the argument from marginal cases by claiming that marginal human beings, just by virtue of their humanity, are more important than animals. Thus, if you do think that every marginal human being is more important than every non-human animal, then the ball is in your court. You have to identify a litmus test of moral importance that is better than the utilitarian one, and one that gives human an edge, no matter how mentally developed they happen to be. It won't be easy to do this. Many think it can't be done. Exercise. See for yourself. Utilitarianism makes it pretty easy to gain entry into the moral community. Infants, toddlers, the severely mentally retarded, the extremely mentally ill, and almost all non-human animals are members. It certainly seems that these people and animals are important in their own right. They are not mere playthings to be used for our own purposes. We owe them respect. Utilitarianism easily explains why this is so. Slippery slope arguments. Utilitarian reasoning is widespread in moral and political arguments. One very popular form that such reasoning can take is that of a slippery slope argument. These arguments are designed to criticize certain social innovations on the grounds that allowing them will lead to terrible results in the long run. The metaphor works like this. Imagine that we are securely positioned at the top of a very steep hill. At the bottom of the hill lies disaster. Once we take even a tiny step from our safe perch, we are destined to tumble all the way down. The slope is slippery precisely because we can't stop ourselves from the inevitable crash. In current debates about genetically modified food, military intervention into distant countries, or state scrutiny of personal emails and letters, some of the most powerful voices come from those who offer slippery slope arguments. There are 2 essential elements to any such argument. The first is a prediction that serious, avoidable harm will result if some new policy or practice is allowed. The argument combines this prediction with the utilitarian requirement to choose options that will minimize harm or maximize happiness. If, for instance, allowing the production and sale of genetically modified food will cause way more suffering and far less benefit than prohibiting it, then we should ban its manufacture and use. According to this argument, doing anything else would be both short-sighted and immoral. Let's unpack the metaphor of a slippery slope by considering a classic example of such an argument, one that opposes voluntary active euthanasia, VAE, deliberately killing a terminally ill patient who has competently requested assistance to end her life. Most opponents of VAE concede that it can sometimes be more merciful than letting nature take its course, since hastening a patient's death can minimize his suffering while also respecting his desire to end his life on his own terms. But that's not the end of the story. Opponents of VAE often argue as follows. If we allow active euthanasia, then we will be authorizing doctors and nurses to sometimes kill their patients. And once medical professionals are making decisions about whose life is worth living and whose life is not, then over time, not next week, next year, or even 5 years from now, but perhaps in a generation or two, our commitment to protecting innocent life will inevitably weaken. Down the road, we will become so morally corrupted that we won't even recognize it as corruption. Medical professionals will be killing elderly patients who want to live, but whose care is extremely expensive. They will be killing infants born with various illnesses and deformities. Perhaps, in a move reminiscent of the Nazi euthanasia programs, which were simply disguised campaigns to murder the inmates of mental hospitals, we will allow the killing of the mentally ill and the mentally retarded, justifying such practices with the claim that we are really doing these patients a favor. Such an outcome rightly strikes us as horrific, and we might think that there is no way that allowing a merciful end to patients' lives will land us in such a morally compromised position. But proponents of this slippery slope argument claim that once we take the fateful step of letting doctors kill their patients, then centuries of moral inhibitions will begin to be erased. To use a different metaphor, we will have opened Pandora's box, and once it is open, there is no way of preventing the dreadful consequences. Here is another example, with lower stakes. From the early 1930s to the mid-1960s, the Hollywood Production Code prohibited the use of profanity, the realistic depiction of serious violence, and any hint of even partial nudity or sexually suggestive scenes. When the code was challenged by directors and studio bosses, its defenders employed straightforward, slippery slope reasoning. They argued that any move away from the status quo would eventually bring us to a point where directors feel free to have their actors use the F word to depict scenes of brutal torture and killing, and to show full nudity and simulated sex in their movies. A scenario that, 50 years ago, seemed so morally outrageous and far-fetched as to be impossible. Clearly, it wasn't. We can undermine a slippery slope argument by showing that the dire forecast at its core is not as plausible as it may seem. The editorial pages of many Southern newspapers in the 1950s and 1960s were filled with slippery slope arguments that foretold the doom that would come if long-standing segregationist laws were lifted. Similar arguments were frequently heard decades earlier in debates about allowing women to vote. Changing the centuries-old prohibition was bound to lead to chaos within families and across society. These predictions were mistaken, and the arguments that incorporated them failed as a result. It is sometimes easy to determine when a prediction of disaster is unreasonable. The slippery slope defenses of Jim Crow laws, for example, were based on unwarranted fears, long-standing prejudice, and deep-seated ignorance. But sometimes it's quite difficult to know whether a prediction at the heart of a slippery slope argument is plausible. This is often the case with truly radical social reforms, ones that have rarely, if ever, been tested. Only a very small number of places have allowed active euthanasia, for instance. And even where it is permitted, it has been legal only for a relatively short time. Without a substantial track record to rely on, it might be unclear whether allowing it will have the disastrous results that opponents predict. In that case, we need further arguments to tell us how to respond to such uncertainty. Opponents of VAE will argue that we should allow it only if we have clear evidence that it won't lead to disaster. Since we lack such evidence, we should continue to forbid it. Supporters of VAE will argue that such a rule would prevent all sorts of morally important social innovations. After all, we can't prove that they will be beneficial if we are never permitted to test them out. Those who favor allowing active euthanasia will further argue that the status quo results in needless suffering, that it undermines a patient's right to self-determination, and that a doctor's primary moral duty is to benefit her patients, and that, in unusual cases, assisting in a patient's death is the best way to benefit him. The arguments here are complicated, and there is no shortcut to developing an informed opinion about this specific issue. The point here, however, isn't to try to settle the matter one way or the other. Indeed, this argument, like all slippery slope arguments, can be evaluated only after taking two steps. We must first evaluate the prediction that lies at the heart of the argument. Will legalizing active euthanasia really have the terrible results that its opponents expect? Will continuing to forbid it have yet worse results? Answers to such questions can be harder or easier to come by depending on the specific issue that is the focus of a slippery slope argument. Still, even in cases where we can come to some reasonable conclusion about the relevant prediction, a slippery slope argument is secure only if its second element, utilitarianism, is also plausible. Is it? Read on.